Hello and good afternoon. I welcome you to today's special webinar, Risk and Money Management, How to Find the Right Position Size exclusively for JFT Brokers. So my name is Jens Klatt and I'm the founder of Jens Klatt Trading and exclusively presenting this event to you for JFT Brokers. So it's a very, very interesting, very fascinating question indeed, how to find the right position size, since I think one of the main problems traders face, especially retail traders face, is they do not really know what is the correct position size, especially in terms of what's the adequate risk I'm willing to take here for a position I take. So based on my personal experience, usually the position size is not just a key factor in terms of profitability and longevity, let's say, here in trading, but it's also usually the case that traders tend to have a way too big, too high position size here when trading, and that way increasing the chances of going broke quite fast. And the question is how to find such a right position size, and I have a quite interesting approach in this context here. So first of all, we want to click through the risk disclaimer, and then while you probably read through this, I'll want to tell you the following. When someone asks me, hey, what is the risk you take per position, I can't give a clear answer. I think this is a very individual question, and something which needs to be where you have to have a deeper understanding of this, let's say. So the thing is, first of all, this is a chart I will, or a graphic I will talk about a little later on about. Usually when you pick up a trading book and you read through any trading book at all, I mean, the first thing you read is take care of the position size, risk minimum, I'm sorry, maximum 1% of your equity. That's usually what you can read here. And another thing is, risking 1% is not necessarily true. So there are trading approaches which we just need to be really careful, and where we have to have a lower risk, clearly lower risk than 1%. There are other trading approaches where it's definitely worth to have a higher risk, something like, I don't know, 5% or something. Usually, and this is the personal experience of me too, it's the case that traders who trade professionally, those traders are usually having a smaller position size to minimize the risks of big drawdowns, while traders who are trading, let's say, trading for fun, it's difficult to say that, but I think you understand what I'm talking about. So who are not considering trading as their main source of income, they usually tend to have a little higher risk here. But all in all, nevertheless, it's a question, it's difficult to answer, since just imagine you have an advantage in your trading, a definite advantage, which is, I don't know, you have a hit rate of 60%, a payoff ratio, the average winner to the average loser, of something like 3-1. It doesn't make sense to risk 1% per trade. I'd risk 3, 4, 5%. I mean, you definitely have the problem that you'll have quite big drawdowns, but the profitability of your trading approach is that high that it's just that you can easily justify having a higher risk here per trade. This is something where the formula of expected value comes into play, by the way. So now today I want to present you an idea of how you can find such a correct position size. But first of all, let's have a short look back at the one of the webinars we had held together here in the last weeks. That was the three columns of profitable trading. And I presented to you my personal think my personal thinking, my thought process here on which columns profitable profitability or profitable trading is built on. It's risk and money management, it's trading psychology, and it's a strategy with an advantage. So these three columns, they interact very closely with each other. And so usually it's clear, or no, and it's not just usually, it should be clear that if one column is missing, the whole building starts to collapse here. So you have to be really careful of all those three columns, and you have to be an expert in every column here, and to make sure that you understand how these columns interact with each other. I gave some small examples here, and so this is something where we remember. First of all, is one column missing? Being profitable in your trading is nearly impossible, since all columns interact strongly with each other. In our case, we're talking about the risk and money management and trading psychology here. And you may probably remember that I said that working, respectively trading, with an adequate position size has consequences on the mental stability of the trader. That makes perfect sense. Since a position size which is far too big will lead to a behavior of fast profit taking and letting losers letting losing trades run. So you can see that the right position size is not just a question of how fast can you grow your capital, respectively how fast can you go broke, but it's also a question of how mentally stable you are. You could easily bring in the third column here and talk about the advantage trading strategy, since thanks to that, you know how big your advantage is or has been in the last months, I don't know, years, and based on that you can easily calculate the correct position size then. But we want to focus here on those two columns, especially risk and money management and trading psychology, since you can easily grasp this concept where you get the idea of, yeah, that if you trade too big, you have usually you will tend to behave in a way which is favoring fast profit taking, letting losing trades run, hope that the market will turn around since you can't afford to lose, and based on that, at the end that at the end you will go in broke doing this, since it's the complete opposite of what you usually should do in your trading. So the right position size has to make sure two things based on my personal experience. So first of all, you should keep potential drawdowns small. It's clear, so you don't want to risk with one trade your whole capital, and if you lose, your account is gone and you're broke. That's the first thing. On top of that, I could easily now put in a little graphic here showing you that it's very, very interesting in terms of drawdown, how much you have to make back to get to break even again. So therefore, just imagine the following. Just imagine you're losing half of your account, okay? So you have a 100,000 euro account, you're losing 50,000. So you need to make back 50,000 or 100% to break even. So it's obvious, obviously, that's very, very important here to keep potential drawdowns small. And how do you get to this point, keeping drawdowns small? Very easy. You have to make sure that your position size is adequate. So that's the first thing. Second, the right position size should also lead to an optimal growth of your equity curve. So no one is trading to break even or just for fun. But the main reason we are all trading is we want to make money. So the correct position size comes into play here too, since the better your account size, your position size fits fits the advantage or pictures the advantage of your trading approach, the better at the end your capital curve will be, and the more money you will make trading the markets. On the other hand, nevertheless, you want to avoid too big drawdown. So all in all, it's two things here. So one is keep losses small, and on the other, you want to make winners big. Very easy. So now, Today, we want to ignore the first one, by the way. So that this is something special, since usually you will hear someone talking about this topic here from a perspective where he says, okay, well, we want to look how to keep potential drawdowns small. But today, we want to take a look at number two. So somehow, as you will see, we will give one some room to develop here, and you will see that I will start to reduce the position size here to avoid two big drawdowns here. But the main focus shall be on point two. So you want to find ways how to get an optimal growth of our equity curve first. So one possibility here is to use the so-called Kelly criterion. I'm not sure if you have heard about this, but it's this is usually a great concept to come closer to this whole concept of optimal position sizing in trading. The reason for that is Kelly answers exactly the second question. So how can I create the optimal growth of my equity curve if I know certain parameters of my trading strategy and with ignoring potential drawdowns here? And so Kelly formula itself is really simple. So the original Kelly formula, it's F equals 2 multiplied with P minus 1. So very easy, in fact. And in this case, F is the amount you're risking per position in percent, and P is your hit rate. So these are where, especially P here, your hit rate seems to be the only component you're looking at. So therefore, let's have a small example here. You have a hit rate of 60%, and Kelly says to get the optimal growth of your equity curve, you have to risk F, you multiply 2 with 0.6, and you subtract 1 from this, you get 0.2, so it's 20%. And that means per position you're taking, you should risk 20% of your capital. So that's, let's say it's a very, in Germany we would call it Forsch, okay? So it's very aggressive. It's very, very aggressive. Just imagine you have 10,000 euros, and then Cali says, okay, risk 2%, 20% of your trading capital, so 2,000 euros. If you lose, you're already down 20%. So nevertheless, based on that, you should be aware of the fact that then here you're not risking again 2,000, but you're risking 20% on 8,000, which you still have. So this makes sure that you will never, ever, 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 ever going broke with your account, but you will have it's called asymptotical. What you will see here. The only problem is rather sooner than later you will have trouble to pay for your trading, for example, in terms of commissions and everything. So this is something you have to take into account here. We're not considering this here in this moment, but something definitely where you have to be really careful about. So usually you can say, purely theoretically, you could say, well, we are not going broke on this approach. Nevertheless, there are commissions, there are trading costs, swap rates if you're holding positions for longer than one night, for example. And everything, and this could get you some serious trouble. Plus, on top of that, 20%, I mean, even if we say position sizing is something individual, something very individual here, it's just too much. It's just too much here. So on top of that, the formula has to be modified since it completely ignores, for example, a very important aspect in your trading, the so-called payoff ratio. So you may remember that during this webinar here about the three columns of profits of trading, I've shown you some charts where you saw the hit rate plus the payoff ratio. So you can probably remember that there were, for example, if you had a hit rate of 50%, losing rate of 50% too, and you had a payoff ratio of 1:1, you're risking 2% of your trading equity, you were nearly 100% sure to go broke thanks to commissions, but also thanks to a variable called variance here. And so this is something which is obviously very important in terms of trading, since you have to make sure that the payoff ratio is significantly bigger one, meaning that your average winner is bigger than your average loser. So what we could do then is to modify Kelly here and say, okay, let's say F is equals the hit rate minus the loss rate, and you divide it through the payoff ratio. So that's the average winner divided by the average loser. So F is still the amount you're risking per position in percent, and the POR is the payoff ratio. So average winner divided by the average loser. And also here, a very simple example to grasp this concept. The hit rate of our system is, for example, 40%, and on average, we're making 3 times more when we win as when we lose. So the payoff ratio is 3 to 1, respectively 3. So if you then put in those variables into this equation here, you get 0.4 minus 0.6 divided through 3. You get 0.4 minus 0.2. You get 20%. Okay, so it's very easy now to say, or where you can obviously see that it's not necessarily true that you need a hit rate of bigger 50%. Now, but nevertheless, let's have a look back here at this example. Just imagine you had just a hit rate here of 40% instead of 60%. So obviously, I made sure that we get a positive we get a positive number here at the end. So just imagine this number is 40% or 0.4. That means you multiply 2 with 0.4, you get 0.8. You subtract 1, you get minus 0.2. So how can you risk less than 0% here? You can't. It's just obvious you can't. Which means you have, in this case here, for the rough Kelly formula, let's call it, you have to consider the payoff ratio, since it should be definitely clear that there are trading approaches out there where you can have a hit rate below 50%, but which are still highly profitable, as shown in several examples here during the last webinars. So which means in this case, you have to consider the payoff ratio here in this case. But what you can also see is the following. Once your expected value is negative, and this is something where I want to come up here with something like this. So let's have a look here. So the expected value was defined as the average winner. You multiply it with the hit rate, and then you subtract the average loser multiplied with the loss rate. So obviously you can see that if you carefully watch at this formula here, you can easily see that somehow the average winner, the average loser is in there, plus the hit rate and the loss rate. So what you can see here is that somehow the expected value finds itself in this formula with the amount you're risking per trade, okay, in percent. And now just imagine the following. You have an expected value which is negative. So saying, for example, that your hit rate is something like, I don't know, let's say 60%, leaving your loss rate at 40%. But now just imagine that your payoff ratio, oh, I'm sorry. Now just imagine that your payoff ratio, so the POR, is 0.5 to 1. So for every dollar you lose, on average, you just gain 50 cent. That's not very good. And if you now put in these components in the formula for the expected value, you get the expected value. You multiply 0.5 with, whoop, one second, with 0.6, and then you subtract 1, the average loser. You multiply it with 0.4. So what do you get? Obviously, you get a number which is smaller, 0. Okay, so now, by the way, here is a minus. So now put in those numbers in this formula here. If you have a hit rate of 60%, you put in this, you have the hit rate of 60%, then you subtract 0.4 and you divide it for 0.5. So meaning that at the end you get the same result as in the first example, as you can see, which is negative, meaning you can't risk, you just can't risk less than 0% on a position. Or put it another way, if your trading approach is not profitable, so you have a negative expected value, you just can't work with Kelly. So if you start to consider Kelly to find the right position size and you get a negative result, you get the red lights flashing, telling you, hey guy, you're losing money with your trading. Okay, so if you never considered this, that could be the first step, in fact, to consider if your trading is profitable or not. And by the way, and if you play a little around with this formula here, what you find out is the lower your expected value, the lower the Kelly bet size. Okay, so if you just have not a big advantage, Kelly will tell you, okay, don't risk too much. That's what Kelly in fact does. So that's it on the theory behind this. Now let me give you some simulated examples, some pictures to get an idea about this. So first of all, you have, or what we will take here is a Bernoulli distributed Monte Carlo simulation. So what is this? It's simple. You just say you have two outcomes. It's one and it's zero. One is you have a winning trade. Zero is you have a losing trade. That's it. And then you say, the moment we have a winning trade, I want to have a payoff which is 150 euros. And if I have a zero, I want to have 50 euros. The hit rate itself is 30%. So it's not very good in terms of the hit rate, but it's still profitable. You can easily calculate the expected value and we'll find out that the overall result is positive. You do not hit very often, but those times you hit big. And that's one of the reasons you're making money in sum at the end of the year. After a certain amount of trading results, you will come out ahead. So that's what you can easily calculate and do here with Excel, for example. So I highly recommend this, by the way, because you can get an idea. And here also trading psychology comes into play. If you simulate your trading based off all those components you have in your trading, but you say, well, I just want to see how would a capital growth look like if there's some several distributions of winners and losers. So just imagine you have a losing streak of 10 trades in a row. So you want to know, are you going broke then? Or how big is the risk of seeing such a sequence of 10 losing trades? If it's a high probability that you're losing 10 times in a row, you can easily handle this. You can easily handle this since you know it when you're trading. Just imagine you're trading but without this information. The problem you have is you just do not know when this will end, and you just do not know, since you haven't ever tried it, if this is normal in your trading or not. The moment you know it's normal that you have 10 losing trades in a row, even though it might be unlikely, it's still possible, you can better handle it. I won't say it's easy to handle it, since losing is not a nice thing, but it's definitely, you're in a better position here than someone who just does not know what he's doing. And so what I did is here, and I have this the following equity growth here. So it's a German chart. I took this from my educational course I'm offering to interested students. And nevertheless, I think it's self-explaining. As you can see here, the blue line shows, okay, obviously you're doing really fine. After 500 trades, you're well ahead, even though you just have a hit rate of 30%. So now the thing is, is this the optimal capital growth, or can we somehow make this better while leaving drawdowns alone, not considering drawdowns something interesting or something, but just saying, okay, what I want to see is an optimal capital growth, ignoring potential drawdowns. And Well, you can either do this with Kelly. So what's the position size with the modified Kelly formula? So what you could do is you could say, okay, we know that F is, in this case, it's TQ. I'm shortening things up here, so I haven't written down hit rate, but it's Trefferquote in German. So TQ is the hit rate. So usually you probably would say HR here in English, while this is the loss rate, so it's LR. In German, it's the Verlustquote. So it's VQ. POR is the payoff ratio. Now, then we take the numbers from the example before. So we have a hit rate of 30%. We have a loss rate of 70%. We divide it by 3, which is the payoff ratio. So what you get is 0.3 minus 0.23, which is 0.07, which is 7%. So what does this tell us? It says that with those numbers, as in the example before, you could easily risk 7% of your trading equity per trade. Okay, that would definitely push the average winner up, but also the average loser. But nevertheless, if you, let's say, have a 10,000 euro account, you could easily risk with those parameters, you could easily risk up to 7% here. So nevertheless, 7% is quite much. And so now I suggest that we have a 50,000 euro trading account. So 7% risk per trade equals to 3,500 euros. It's probably too big, even if you're a very aggressive trader and can handle the emotional swings in your account well. 7% is just a lot. That's all I say. It's not about 3,500 euros. So for you, you might say, well, what's 3.5? Someone else might say, well, I'm working 40 hours a week, 4 weeks a month to gain less than that. With a job I don't like, so that for someone like this, it's a huge amount of money. So it's relative, but all in all, I can say, especially with a hit rate of 30%, usually those emotional swings are quite big then if you're risking 3.5, so 7% per trade. So what could you do here? You could work with something which is called the risk of ruin. So this is, in fact, the max DD. It's the drawdown you're willing to take and when you stop your trading and overlook what's going wrong. So imagine the following. You say, I have a 50,000 euro trading account, and my personal risk of ruin is 50% of that. That means you're risking 25,000. If you lost 25,000, you stop trading. You could easily adapt this then if you're performing well. So just imagine you're making 100,000 out of those 50,000. You could easily say, if I now lose 50%, which is 50,000, well, then I'm done. At the end, you're breaking even, so you haven't lost anything. You haven't gained anything too. But and this is called the risk of ruin, or the max drawdown you're willing to take. So what I'm doing here is, by the way, I'm mixing things up a little. So the risk of ruin, or the risk of going broke, is not necessarily the same as the max drawdown you're willing to take. So usually you have to be really careful here, since the max drawdown could be, for example, 10%. So then your risk of ruin is 10% of your trading equity. So that way around, it makes more sense then. So, and now say, what you could do is you could reduce your risk of ruin by 50% from, let's say, initially 100%, which meaning that you're willing to lose these 50,000, and then go down by 50% to 25,000. That means, on the other hand, that you're also splitting your 7% to in half, making it 3.5%, and now saying that you're only willing to risk 1,750 euros per position. So this is 3.5% risk per trade based on the original account size of 50,000 euros. That's something you could easily do. And if you now say, well, still 3.5%, that's quite much. Now you could easily say, I go a further step and reduce the volatility in the equity curve. And I take the square root of this result. So 3.5, you take the square root of this, which is 1.8, and then you put the percentage behind this, and then you're risking 1.8% per trade here. So this is still a number which is significantly above 1%. But as you can see, you have a very, very detailed and good idea of why you're doing what you're doing. So what you know is you know the parameters of your trading, and what you want to get is you want to make as much money as possible by having an adequate risk here, which is from a mathematical standpoint completely fine. And this is suiting well your trading parameters. And now what you could do is the following. You have a simulated example here, and let's go with the adaptive position size and see what we get after 500 simulated trades. This is enormous, okay? So you have in blue the line capital without Kelly, so just saying I'm risking 1%, okay? So if you remember, by the way, initially I was working with a 50,000 euro account, but with a 5,000 euro account, but it doesn't matter. You can easily adapt those numbers and then scale them up or scale them down. If I'm risking 50 euros, that means 1%. In this case, now you're risking 1.8%. So you can imagine what happens the moment we are risking 7% here. So it would explode on the upside. The problem is, and this is something you have to take into account here, and there's the thing, and why I personally have to be really careful, since this is usually what I do. I tell the people, consider risk and money management from the losing perspective, not from what you could gain and how to optimize your winnings, even though that's usually the way people do things here. So what you can easily see is that you have massive drawdowns. So just imagine following, you're trading a 5,000 euro account here. So you can easily put a zero on this. Let's say it's a 50,000 euro account. So you're pushing up your equity by 30,000 or 3,000 if it's a 5,000 euro account. So you're trading it up to 80,000, and then you're going down here. That was after the first 50 trades or something, and then after 150 trades, so 100 trades later, you're at nearly break even again. So you never ever are in the red zone. It's completely fine, but consider the fact that here you're going down from 80,000 to, in this case, 50,000 again. So it's, you might say it's not a big deal, but take into account here, if you're looking at the blue line, if you compare the drawdown here of something like 20-25% of your equity, just imagine here what happens in this case. So you're pushing up your account by let's say 20%, and then you're going down here. This is nearly half of the volatility you're getting in your equity curve by risking just 1%. On the other hand, well, if you start to gain, you really gain. That's something you can easily spot here. So the market is pushing higher, boom, 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 and it's nearly doubling your account after 500 trades. Depends on how much trades you make, but this is the pros and the cons in one chart, if you want. So the drawdowns are getting higher. The higher your risk is, on the other hand, it's from a mathematical standpoint, it's completely fine to risk a higher amount if you have a bigger edge. And when you're doing fine, you're really doing fine, and the market is pushing in your direction. So now, let's have a look here at the summary. So the Kelly criterion is giving you the chance to find out the optimal position size for an optimal growth of your equity curve while ignoring potential drawdowns. I do not recommend ignoring drawdowns. That's something I want to emphasize here. So I'm not saying ignore drawdowns. Instead, do the complete opposite. But what I want to present to you here in this webinar is I want to make sure that you get an idea of how you could, from a mathematical standpoint, optimize your position size and find the correct position size. So this is just, by the way, one thing. You could easily go with other things here, like there's several things like Martingale, which you shouldn't do. You could use something like Optimal F or something. So there are several ways of finding or having ideas, getting ideas of on how to optimize your position size, find the right position size. But I do not recommend ignoring the potential drawdowns, even though this was exactly what we did here in this spot. It's very important, if you're using Kelly when finding your correct position size, that does not necessarily mean you get a better performance. When especially trading leverage products, and when you're pushing the envelope too far, you will probably face massive drawdowns and potentially kill your account. So let's come back here. So I'm also a money manager, and I'm also managing clients' money. Just imagine the following. Even though you're pushing the account here up by, I don't know, like I said, 60% or something. So you're trading a 50,000 euro account and you're pushing it up to 80,000. It's enormous. And if you do this after 50 trades, it's even more enormous. And your clients will be really happy, cheering, and everything's cool. But now imagine the following. You're here in this case, you're on the right side of the variance, right? So just imagine you're starting out here, you're breaking even, and then you start to face a drawdown, in this case, by 20, 25, 30%. As I already mentioned at the beginning, you have to make all this money back to break even and then start to make money for your clients. So first of all, your clients won't accept this. If you're losing 30% of the account of your clients, well, you're nearly done, okay? So this is the way it is. So people will call you, will say, well, sorry, but you might be a nice guy, but you have no clue about trading. Even though you have profitable trading strategy and everything, if you lose 30%, 33% of the account of your clients, well, you have to make back 50% of the money to break even again. Okay, so take this as an example. If you're trading a 100,000 euro account, you're losing 33,000. So you lost 33%. You're at 66.67. And so you know you have to make back 50% of that. So if you lost one third, you have to make back 50% to break even, to be at I'm 100,000. And so I definitely can tell you, you won't survive. You won't survive this, since the clients will take the money away. So you're probably not doing this the moment you're managing client funds or something like this. And so the massive drawdowns you could face, even though from a mathematical standpoint that makes sense and you can easily double the account in no time, nevertheless it means that you could face tremendous problems here, and especially when trading leveraged products here, not just facing massive drawdowns, but potentially kill the account. So if you push the envelope too far, you have definitely a problem when just using the Kelly criterion without adapting it. So a potential solution here is that you're trading one part if you're trading capital aggressively with Kelly. So let's say you're trading a 100,000 euro account, and then you say, okay, I take 10,000 out of it, I'm trading it aggressively with Kelly, I optimize it, and trade those 10% with Kelly here, and the other part I traded very conservatively. So just saying, okay, well, I'm risking as usual 0.5 to maximum 1% here. And so this is a potential solution, and definitely something. Wait, what happens now? Okay. This is definitely something which is worth considering it, since it could be considered as kind of diversification of your portfolio if you want. And on top of that, Kelly perfectly shows that you need to have a trading strategy with a positive expected value. Remember this. What I just presented here is exactly this. So if you get a negative number here with the expected value, or if you're not allowed to use Kelly in your trading, since Kelly gives you a negative number and you can't risk a negative amount in percentage terms here of your trading capital, well, I tell you, this is the thing. You definitely have a problem, since you do not have a trading strategy with a positive expected value, since the expected value is already in the Kelly formula, in the optimized Kelly formula. So what you need to have is a trading strategy with a positive expected value, and there it all starts again. This is something you have to make sure that you have exactly that. You have a positive expected value, respectively, you have an edge in your trading, and this is the starting point of your trading. It should be the starting point of your trading, and then, and only then, you are capable of considering using the Kelly criterion for your trading strategy. So yeah, that's it from my end. I hope you enjoyed the presentation, and I hope you liked what I had to say here. That was just a rough overview of how you could use an optimized position size. I made sure in the morning meeting already, in the German and also in the English version, I made sure that you understand this. By the way, that's something I promised to show you. So the thing is that if you have a position and this position is running against you, here, as you can see, I have two trades on right now. So it's the Aussie dollar and it's the Euro GBP. While Euro GBP broke below 86 and is running in my direction, and I'm really happy to see this, since I waited some time for this, I have the position already on since the 16th of March, 2 weeks from today. I opened the position. Some days later, I opened the Aussie USD, which is still not trading in my direction. Nevertheless, I'm capable of handling a potential pullback here against this hard resist on the upside. This is the exact target. I want to see a break here. I was stopped into this trade shortly before we started this corrective move here. Market moved 100 pips against me, but I didn't had any problems with that since the position size was adequate. I know what I'm doing every time I'm trading, and then this is exactly the thing. So if you do not know what you're doing, if you do not know your edge, if you do not know if you have an edge, and you're just gambling around a little, that's what it is, you will have definite problem to keep on such a position and have the confidence to hold with to go with such a position here. You really have to trust your position here in this case. And so yeah, that's the last thing I want to add here. And that's it from my end. I hope you, as already said, enjoyed the presentation, and I wish you a nice afternoon, have a nice evening, and talk to you again then tomorrow in the morning meeting here in the YouTube channel from JFD Brokers. Talk to you tomorrow then. I look forward to it. Have a nice evening. See you, and bye-bye.